I'm sitting here with Dave Bottrell, aka Dirty Six or Bots. How you doing tonight, Bots?
Yeah, good, mate. Good. Late finish to my work clobber, but we got there.
You've had a very long career in Speedway sidecars, and you've sort of done it in a way that's really interesting to me, and I'd like to find out more. So from what I could gather, you do your stints in different states, but you also do your work there at the same time. So how does that all come about?
I suppose after my accident, I decided I was going to do a little bit more, tailor my work around my life rather than the other way around. So, yeah, pretty lucky with the job I do. I do firefighting mainly, because I'm an electrician. So I can sort of pick and choose, and there's always work where I land. So if we down there, say, for instance, I'll stay down there for a month or two and pick a bit of work up, or back up this way, or even WA, there's plenty on over there too. So.
It's a different way of doing it, because most people have to, because they're, you know, where they're based or whatever, they have to either drive all their stuff there, leave it there, and then fly to and from. But you've sort of found this works best for you.
Well, I've still got family in SA and that, so, and when you race down south or towards the East Coast area, you know, like you're either basing yourself in, or Gilman's always had a lot of meetings on. You're 4 hours from Mildura. Really, you can ride every weekend when you're down there, and if that's the case, and depending on where the Aussies are that year, you just make a plan to do a few before there at the track, and just to get a bit of a tune up.
You did have a really big crash in your career, and you've had a couple of really big ones. So, when was your last really big crash as such, and what was the injuries taken away from that?
Big one in 08 at Pioneer Park. Just into the wall, and sort of that threw me. Well, I was 2 years off work from that one, and 6 years later, I had my last op. So that happened in 08. And 2014, I took the last of the medal out. So they asked me to ride in Mooney's memorial meeting that year, and I threw Mick Ing on the side, just because Mick was with Gary, obviously, when it all happened. And we thought it'd be a good thing to show a little bit of play. And we went out and we went pretty good. So I thought I'd better buy one and have another crack. I originally wasn't going to ride again. And but it was a kid, because I sort of put them through a bit of hell, the family and that. So they're the ones that said, "Dad, just buddy, do it. You're a pain in the arse, you know." So they're the ones that sort of said, "Yeah, just go and do it. It's what you love doing." So. Yeah, back having another little crack, still enjoying it.
I've actually been at the track when you've had a big one, and just like every sidecar competitor, you will refuse medical help. You say you're all right. I think that the saying was, "I'm ready to do a couple of push-ups after hitting the wall at Brisbane." So, you know, it's just crazy how hard-nosed you guys are.
No one's ever accused me of being smart, so. That's it comes easy for me, I suppose. But yeah, I know. Like, I started off racing at five years old, riding motocross. So that's pretty well all I've known. Dad raced, so never speedway. We're always there was always sort of a bit taboo in our family. Like, we used to go and watch it and think it was great, but it was always a blood sport, you know. And it was something to go and enjoy and just marvel, that sort of thing, but it's nothing you really want to throw your leg over.
How how did all this start?
Yeah, well, Adelaide boy. I was born in Adelaide. Around the motocross tracks. Dad was riding. He used to ride solos and then scrambles back then, but motocross sidecars. That was his thing. And so I was on a bike by about 3 or 4, I think. And race juniors and that all down south here or Adelaide. I forget where I am sometimes. And and then he had work overseas, so I spent 6 years in Papua New Guinea at school and that, like junior primary and things like that, which was good. It was different, but and then in between, it was always 2 years there and back for a stint. And so sort of was a mix sort of thing with my sport, but I had a few too many injuries. I think I retired from full-time motocross at about 18 after a bit too much damage. So then a good mate of Dad's, Adrian Bird, he used to be a passenger. He was actually on with Brian Schultz when Brian Schultz got killed at Port Pirie. And he ended up riding and he got me drunk. Well, he didn't get me drunk. I was drunk at my 21st and he asked me what I was doing next weekend and he said nothing. He goes, oh, you might as well drop on this just for help me run it in. And I ended up doing the season with him and thought, yeah, well, I've had a look now. I might as well grab a set of handlebars and see how I go. That was the beginnings.
You've also said you've got a pretty big fondness for AFL as well. So is motorsport the biggest sport you're into, or is it sort of you're into a whole myriad of things?
I watch any sport. I play most of them. So I played footy and that I was actually playing under 17s level at like state level in South Australia there. And then they said, we got to play Sundays. And that was when I rode motocross. So that was the end of the footy. But I enjoy any sport, you know, like speedway's good in a way. It's the sidecars it's an individual sport, but it's not. And it's there's a lot more behind it. You know, like obviously it's not just you and your passenger. It's I've had quite a few relationships, I suppose, but that's your family that's involved. It's a big drain on everyone. So you've got to get that right mix to try and get a result at the end of the day. If your head's not in it or pieces are missing, you know, your performance normally wanes a bit as well.
What's it like to come across a passenger and then how do you know when you're starting to click? Is it the personality or is it on the track?
Both, because you do well, ideally you spend that much time together, you got your shed time. And like a fellow that got me involved in it when I first bought a bike was Peter Fleet. He was top runner down in South Australia and taught me a lot, but he was minimum 40 hours in the shed a week doing his bike, and I just couldn't fathom how 40 hours related to 6 minutes of track time. And then you go and do another 40 hours in the shed the week after to do that next 6 minutes, because all going well, you do your 5 heats and your final. And that is the big drain on them. And if you have a passenger that's invested in it with you, and he can spend that time with you, you also learn about the bike and you're actually talking about things and doing things in the shed while you're working on it, which, you know, collates to a result on the weekend because you're both on the same page. distance is a hard thing up here, you know, like I've got young Shane Coathurst, he's keen now. Now the big gorilla's going to finally hop off. I think he's pulled the old one more card. He's having a ride at Mooney's next weekend or weekend after. But yeah, I've got young Shane, he's 17 or something. I think he was on with us at the last Queensland title, his first sort of ride. So yeah, no, he's keen, he's young, he's fit, wants to learn. And so that's good when, you know, someone like that, you can, well, right or wrong, you teach them your way, what you expect, what you want. Because we all ride the bikes different. Some want the passenger to do a lot more. Some want the passengers to be a constant and hop off it and do more of the steering themselves, you know.
Chris has hopped on with you and done a fair bit with other riders and that as well. But what's it like going out the track with your son on the back of the bike?
That was always a hard one. I was actually breaking one of my rules because I always said I'd never ride with family or a female on the back. Just in the fact that I need someone big enough and ugly enough to, if you've got a clown there that smacks them in the back, they can go, you know, your head's in the game still. You're not worried about them getting hurt and all the rest of it, because emotions do come into it. So, yeah, but he actually blackmailed me to hop on, so. He said he wanted to hop on, and I took him for a ride around Brandon, Woodstock actually, and I wanted to try a set of pipes. I said, oh yeah, hop on. I said, well, he said, you could hop on. So we did a few laps, and he did all right, the big fella, and then he's reminded me of that not long later, and he's sort of piped up and said, well, why don't I hop on for the year? And I told him the same reasons, and he goes, well, Brady Carnes asked me to swing for him, but I'd rather you swing with you because I know you look after me, you know. And I'm sort of, you little prick, you know, pulling up at him. And yeah, so he said, well, if I don't hop on with you, I'll hop on with him. So I said, well, I'd rather try and look after you. And not that Brady wouldn't. But yeah, so that's how it all started.
You're a family man for sure, and they do travel with you to meetings. And I noticed that Alex comes to some meetings as well, like down my way and that. It seems like you got a pretty loyal supporters group, and, you know, things like with your stubby holders and that, when you put them up for sale, I couldn't wait to get one. I've still got one right now. But what's it like to have a little core group that's so tight?
Yeah, it's very important, you know, like these guys, like the beauty of me having kids young is that you get to grow up with them, you know. So I'm still doing sport with my son, you know. And Alex, she's been involved in it from the get-go sort of thing. She's hovering around the background here. And it's great, you know, like they don't say too much. They don't, you know, like it's a pat on the back when you do well, and it's like, you know, band-aids when they come to see you in hospital, and it's you know, bad luck when you don't. So yeah, but they're there all the time. They're a constant, which is great.
I want to know also, what's the fascination with yellow and green?
Well, green was supposed to be unlucky, and I think I've probably proved that. But green's always been my colour, I don't know, so. And then back when Tappy first started getting involved, it was, he went to Razzmatazz a bit more, you know, like, so I thought, I was sort of like an aqua sort of green then, and it was time to step it up a little bit, so that's when I bought the fluoro out, the fluoro green, the fluoro yellow. Like I said, the 6 years off after my crash and all the rest of it, I thought maybe green isn't so lucky, so I went to the black background but still kept the green in it, and that didn't work either. So, I don't know, I might just keep it white.
guess your bikes and your Kevlars and everything have always been presented well, but what's the deal with the number 36? Why that number?
At the time, like, Speedway's pretty big down here when I started, SA when I started. So really, you were allocated a number or given a choice of a handful. Well, that's all you had, you know. So motocross, I was three. I rode number three for a fair while, and I had six as well. So I just put the two together, I suppose. And 36 seemed a reasonable number. So that's just what we ran with.
In your career, you've obviously raced a lot of venues, and you know you've caught the wave sometimes with people like David Tapp doing his thing, and you know, Dave Parker and people like that. But what was sort of the era that really stood out for you where you thought that Speedway was just peaking and you were just racing constantly?
Probably just leading up to to 08 when I had my accident. Like, I think we were in Germany in 05 for the world title. Back to the UK in 06 or maybe 06 and 07. We didn't go to France. That's why we missed out on France, because there was a bit of politics about all that one. back then it was like we were angling for a world title. FIM sanctioned the whole bit and it was going to kick off. And, you know, like me and Darren used to talk about, the dream was always to be able to do what the solo boys do, you know, like imagine just doing a race three times a week and that's your bread and butter, you know. Like couldn't think of a better way to do it, you know. But back then, like, you know, Glenn was going, Darren was going, Mooney was going, Scotty Christopher. It was hard charges all the way through Drewy, but you could just keep going, you know, Blokes you could race with hard, but more so then I think the camaraderie was there, probably more so then than now to a degree, you know, it's not across the board, it's not universal, you know. But yeah, you still got all the old school guys there and the young ones trying to make a name, which is always good fun too.
Who are some of the people you've seen? You know, we've had a bit of a limited sort of season this last year gone, but who are some of the people you've seen that you've sort of gone, wow, they're pretty talented off the bat?
Yeah, I think young Ricky House is young fella. They just come straight out of juniors. They made it through from the qualifier, the Aussies, you know, first time through. So, they're nice and smooth and fast, and you can see the junior programs actually work real well. And they're a product of it, you know. Young Jake's going to be riding this year, Darren's lad, you know. And you can see they learn their racecraft in the juniors, and that's hopefully what, you know, we've been trying to get it happening a bit more up here, but we're just going to get a bit more stable with tracks. And once we do that, we'll get a couple of juniors going, or Brody and myself have talked about it, and just throw some kids on them. I'll be on my pension soon, so I'll start looking after the young ones.
Well, it's funny you say about the House family, because I got to watch them run the New South Wales titles, and they were so fast off the bat and so young. So I think they've got a very long career ahead. And like you say, the junior feeder program, even in, you know, years gone by, it was a really good thing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. That's where they learn their craft. And I think the beauty of that is that they learn that they're on weapons, basically. At least they've got a grounding before it, you know. Like, whereas with the numbers dwindling, I suppose, to a degree, you used to be able to – when I first started, I had to go down to North Arm on Thursday evening, and there'd be a couple of MA guys there, and they'd watch me do so many laps on my own, make sure I look safe and all the rest. And they'd throw a flag out in the track and make you do an emergency stop and all this sort of stuff, you know. And then they'd tick you off and go, right, you're right to go and sit with your jerry can on the infield for for a season until you get a spot into a field, you know, like that's how it worked. But as it is now, you can buy my bike and you'll be at the tapes next to me that weekend because you're a number to fill a slot. And anyone can drop a clutch, but the trouble is what happens when you get that first corner first and you're on a missile that you don't really know how to control. And that's where I think the juniors eliminates a lot of that.
I've never really thought about, but it's dead true where you really can, or you could ring up, say, Bernie and get yourself a Mitch with a really healthy motor and, you know, mum and dad have got money and then bang, you could be racing 2 weeks' time and what happens if it starts to go pear-shaped?
No, that's it, you know. Like, and there's a lot of good initiatives that people are trying to bring in, you know, like to get more people involved and all the rest of it, you know. Like, I think we were talking just in general the other day about the Aussie title fields and, you know, getting how they're selected and time trials and things like that to get more people involved and all the rest of it, you know. You just got to be careful how that translates into the best riders for that night, you know, because it doesn't always, like we're saying, like, anyone can hold a pin for a lap, but you do it with three other people out there that you've got to use a bit of racecraft with and do it for four laps straight, not just one out of the bag. That'll get you into a title and then not know what to do when you're in it, you know. So there's a little bit behind it. Like, initiatives are good, I think, to encourage more people to travel to these titles and all the rest of it, you know. Like, whether we need to go to a sprint car type formula, you know, like, where it's not just it might be a three-night show, you know, and you have your groups, you know, your C main, your D main, you know, but to qualify up, or I don't know, there's a lot of different ways you could look at it, but just have to be careful we don't get it wrong at that point. Yeah, that's all.
There definitely is a need for people on the paper side of things. Absolutely, with anything, we could be running a lemonade stand and we need admin to help out, but I do think there needs to be a way, and I'm not sure how that would happen, to have the conversation openly, kind of like what we are now, about what are some of the ideas we could have that could benefit everyone as such, but also safely.
Sometimes before, sometimes after, but there was a forum at every Aussie title, so in theory, you had, that was probably back before the qualifying side of things, because we'll run pairs then. But you'd have 16 of the best around the country that are there, and all these things would be broached, you know, like any concerns, you know, like we go back to refereeing, and choice of refereeing has always been a big sticking point, and how many level threes or whatever have we got to do those titles that are actually capable of doing them as well, you know, like, and then we get back to, like, well, why don't we, you know, like, it was costing everybody to get transponders on their bikes at Gilman so you could, you know, check a time. Well, wouldn't that, instead of throwing that money onto the riders to get that sort of transponder thing done, why wouldn't you put the money down to get a GoPro on each corner? So if there is something so blatant, you go, look, mate, it's right there in front of us. There's a screen next to you. You know, like, there's too much of the, no, that's the way I saw it and that's the way it is, you know. But it can't be that black and white when someone's basically spent their superannuation to get there for that meeting. and it's up to someone's pig-headedness someone's opinion only, you know, like, whereas there's technology in every other sport in the world, yet we don't use it.
We're not here to slam anyone. That's definitely not what's happening. But you are right. There is a need for certain things, and where that money comes from to implement that, I'm not sure. But at the same time, it would be really cool to see some little changes happen. even if we had spotters like they do in NASCAR or something. I'm not sure. Yeah.